Hello students, welcome back. Myself Hiral Patia from SNPIRC, UMAC. In last video we have started the unit of database management system, data models. Okay, in last video we have covered entity relationship model. In that, entity set, attributes and relationship set. Entity set means you can say particular object or thing, and the properties of that object is known as attributes. And the relationship means there are two entities and we connect that two entities via a particular word and we make the statement, right? So that word is known as relationship, that we have learned in previous video. Now, types of entity set. Okay, there are two kind of entity set, strong entity set and weak entity set, right? What is strong entity set? So strong entity has a primary key. Okay, primary key means which has a unique identifier. Okay, in particular table there is a unique identifier column, right? That known as primary key. Now weak entities are dependent on the strong entity. Its existence is not a dependent on any other entity. Strong entity is represented by a single rectangle like this. The customer is a strong entity. Why customer is strong entity? Because we have attributes like customer ID, right? So for each and every customer there is a different customer ID. We can identify each customer by their ID, right? Another example is students, right? For each college there is a different students. Okay, so for each student there is a PAN number, right? So for by using that PAN number we can identify the student. Okay, for a same college, same class, not a single PAN number is used for two different students, right? So that is the primary key. Now weak entity. An entity set that does not have a primary key is called weak entity set. Okay, particular entity values for that entity are not identified individually, uniquely, right? So that kind of entity set is known as weak entity set that does not have any primary key. See in this figure, loan and payment, both are the entities. Okay, loan has attributes loan number, amount. Okay, so loan number is your primary key for the loan entity. Okay, so it is a strong entity set, right? So loan number, for each and every loan there is an individual loan number, individual loan ID, right? But for payment, payment number it is not a unique number. Why? Because for a one loan there is a payment number, there are number of payments for on single loan, right? So your payment number is just like a sequence number. Okay, so for second kind of loan there is another payment sequence number, right? So that using that payment number we cannot identify that this payment is done for which kind of loan. Okay, so payment is your weak entity, right? And it is indicated by double rectangle, and this is our strong entity which is indicated by single rectangle, right? So weak entity set is indicated by double rectangle and weak entity relationship set is indicated by double diamond like this. Okay, this is relationship between loan and payment, but here we have a weak entity set. So this relationship is also known as a weak entity relationship. Okay, next is mapping cardinality, right? Cardinality constraints. Mapping cardinality means it represents the number of entities of another entity set which are connected to an entity using a relationship set. Okay, what it means? There are two entity sets, okay, not two entities. There are two entity sets. Entity set means collection of multiple entity, right? So from one entity set, and we connect the single entity to another entity set. Now this is the mapping, right? So there are, for binary relationship set, the mapping cardinality must be one of the following type. So we can say that there are four kind of mapping cardinality: one to one, one to many, many to one, and many to many. Now one to one relationship, which indicate 1-1, right? 1-1 means, see here, an entity in A is associated with only one entity in B, okay? And an entity in B is associated with only one entity in A. Now what is A and B? So A and B are the entity sets, right? This is entity set A, in that A1 and A2 are the entities. For this entity set B, B1 and B2 are the entities. Okay, so A1 is connected to B1, A2 is connected to B2. One entity from A is connected with one entity from B, right? So it indicates 1-1. Okay, for example, see here, customer is connected with only one loan using a relationship borrower, and loan is connected with only one customer using the borrower. Customer and loan, these two are entities, right? So C1, one customer is connected with one loan, another customer is connected with another loan. C1 to L1, C2 to L2, C3 to L1, L3, right? So this kind of relationship is known as 1-1. Okay, 1-1, and here near this entity customer we write 1, and here we can write also 1. So it indicates 1-1 relationship. Okay, next is 1-many. 1-many means, from one entity set, that is single entity, which is connected with multiple entities of another entity set. See here, an entity in A is associated with more than one entities in B, and an entity in B is associated with only one entity in A, right? See in this figure, A entity set, A1, A2 are entities, B entity set, B1, B2 are entities. A1 is connected with B1 and A1 is also connected with B2, right? But B1 and B2 both are connected to A1 only, single entity from A, okay? So this side there is only single entity, and this side you can say multiple entities which has a relationship, right? So this kind of relationship is 1-many relationship, and which indicate by 1 and N. Okay, see in this example, customer 1 has a two kind of loan. For example, educational loan, personal loan, right? Customer 2 has a, again, two kind of loan. It has a car loan, okay, or you can say a business loan, right? So for single customer, it can borrow multiple loan, right? On same account, you can say. So here we can write 1 and here we can write N. It means one customer can borrow multiple loan. So this kind of relationship is 1-many relationship. Okay. Next is many to one relationship. Right. So here this A entity set has entities A1, A2, which is connected with B1 only in entity set P. Right. So what we can say, an entity in A is associated with only one entity in B, but an entity in B is associated with more than one entities in A. Okay, so for example, there are two customers want to buy a car. So from bank they want to loan for car, right? So there is a single attribute, you can say car loan. Okay, so two customer wants to take a car loan, right? So what it means, from the customer entity set, two customer are connected with the single entity in loan, Right? See, a loan is connected with more than one customer using borrower, and customer is connected with only one loan using borrower. This is just a reverse of one to many. Okay, so it indicates by n to one. So we write here n and here one. It means many to one relationship. Okay, next is many to many relationship. Many to many means from this entity set A, multiple entities are connected with the multiple entities from the another entity set. As you can see in this figure, A1 is connected with B1, B2 both, and B1 is also connected with A1, A2 both. Right? So we can say that an entity in A is associated with more than one entities in B, and an entity in B is associated with more than one entities in A. Okay, so here we can see in example, a customer is connected with more than one loan using borrower, and loan is connected with more than one customer using borrower. Right, single customer can take a car loan and personal loan both. Okay, and two different customer can take a single loan, means car loan. Both are want to borrow a car loan, or you can say both are want to borrow particular business loan, you can see, right? So this indicates by N to N. So we write near customer N and near loan N. It means it indicates many to many relationship. Okay, now next topic is generalization. Okay, what do you mean by generalization? So it is a process of extracting common properties from a set of entities and create a generalized entity from it. Okay, it is a bottom up approach in which two or more entities can be generalized to a higher level entity if they have some attributes in common. Okay, for example, let's we see one figure. As we know, it is a bottom up approach, right? Bottom up approach means faculty, student, these two are entities. Okay, so from these two entities, which attributes are common? You can say customer name, address, contact number. Okay, so these are the common attribute for faculty and student. So we generalize these to a person. Okay, and we make an attribute for that person, P address, P name. Okay, so these both attribute belong to same faculty and student. So we generalize that faculty is a person, or you can say student is a person, right? But the attributes which differ these two entities, which differentiate these two entities, that we have to indicate on particular entity, like student P, right? That is not belong to faculty. In faculty, there is a attribute salary, which is different to student entity, right? So student fee is belong to only student entity. So this kind of concept is known as generalization. Okay, bottom to up approach. Now next is specialization. Specialization means from higher entity we can derive the lower entity, right? Generalization, in generalization what happened, we are going to make a higher level entity from the lower level entity, and in specialization, from higher level entity we are going to create a lower level entities. So we can say that any an entity is divided into sub entities based on their characteristics, right? Example, we can see in figure, employee, right? Employee has a common attribute salary, name, address, contact number, right? So, but which kind of employee we have? So there's a tester, developer, and many more, right? So here we have taken two entities, tester and developer, which is the employee of particular employee management system, right? For a particular company. So from employee, we have derived two entities, tester and developer. So we can say that employee is a tester or employee is a developer. Top to down, top down approach, right? So same like generalization, the common attributes are belong to higher level entity and the different attributes are belong to particular low level entities, like a tester type. Which kind of tester is there? Okay, so it is the attribute of tester. And which kind of developer is there? It is a attribute of developer. Okay, so this is a specialization. Now the limitation of ER diagram. Okay, limitation of ER diagram means we cannot make a relationship between two relations. Right? We can make a relationship between two entities only, not between two relationship. Okay, these are the limitation, or you can say single limitation of ER diagram. We cannot express relationship between two different relations. Now next topic is aggregation. We have seen generalization, we have seen specialization. Right? It works on the entities. Right? Now this aggregation is works on relationship. Right? So aggregation is a process where the relation between two entities is treated as a single entity. Right? In aggregation, relationship with its corresponding entities is aggregated into higher level entity. Right? We will learn this with example also, right? So we can say that aggregation is a merging of, you can say, concept of particular system, right? So an abstraction through which relationships are treated as a higher level entities. Let's see one example. Okay, this diagram shows that employee is connected with manager via relation manages. An employee is connected with the branch via manages. Okay, job is also connected with manages. It means manager is managing employee, manager is manages branches, manager manages a particular job. Okay, so and this work on relationship, it is connected with employee, job and branch. Okay, this indicates the ternary relationship, as we have learned in previous video, right? Three entities are connected via single relationship, it means ternary relationship. Okay, but what happened here? Aggregation means it just like you can say it looks like complicated, right? Via manager manages employee, manager manages branch, manager manages job. But when we apply our aggregation, what we have to do? We can make a relation with relation. Just link. We cannot make a relationship between two relations, right? But we can just link two relations via aggregation concept. Okay, so how to apply the aggregation concept, right? So relationship set work on and manages. These two are relationship, okay, which represent the overlapping information. How? So you can say that every manages relationship correspond to a work on relationship. Okay. However, the some work on relationships may not correspond to any manages relationship. What this statement says, manages relationship, it depends on work on relationship, right? Because employee works on particular branch, right? That manager has to manage. Okay, but some work on relationship may not correspond to any manager's relationship. Employee can work on particular job, employee can work on particular branch, right? That is not dependent on manager's relationship, right? So we cannot discard the work on relationship. We cannot discard the work on relationship because it is an independent relationship. Okay, so eliminate this redundancy via aggregation. Okay, so treat relationship as an abstract entity, or you can say allow relationship between relationship or abstraction of relationship into new entity. Now how you can eliminate? So you can say that we cannot create any relationship between two relationship, but we can connect that two relationship. Okay, So in real world, we know that manager not only manages the employee working under them, but he has to manage the project as well, like a job entity, right? In such scenario, if entity manager make a manages relationship with either employee or project entity alone, then it will not make any sense because he has to manage both, right? We cannot say that manager can manage only employees, or we cannot say that manager can manage only projects. It has to manage both employees and projects, right? So in this case, the relationship of two entities act as one entity. Okay, so in our example, the relationship work on between employee and project act as one entity that has a relationship manages with the entity manager. Okay, like this, we can make this block containing ternary relationship between employee, job and branch, that is work on, and it is directly connected to manages relationship, which is connected with the manager attributes, manager entity, right? So manager entity, its task is manager manages works regarding employee, job and branch, all of this. Okay, so this is, we can say, aggregation, right? Okay, next topic is constraint on specialization and generalization, right? Constraint, what do you mean by constraint? You can say that constraint means identification for particular entities, right? So there are two kind of constraint, disjoint and participation, right? From disjoint, we can elaborate disjoint attribute and non-disjoint attribute, right? Or you can say constraint. And in participation, there are two constraints, total participation and partial participation. Total participation means it is mandatory, and partial means it is optional, okay? So disjoint constraint, what it means? So it describes the relationship between the members of the superclass and the subclass, and it indicates whether a member of superclass can be a member of one or more than one subclass, right? So in disjoint, what we can say, there is a one superclass, right? So for that superclass, how many subclass are there? One or more than one, right? So there are two kind of disjoint constraint. One is disjoint and another is non-disjoint, that is overlapping, you can say another name, right? So disjoint constraint means it specifies that entity of superclass can belong to only one lower level entity set, or you can say subclass, and it is specified by d, small d, or by writing disjoint near a Isar triangle, right? Isar triangle, which is we have used in specialization and generalization. Okay, and non-disjoint overlapping constraint, it means it specifies that an entity of superclass can belong to more than one lower level entity set, more than one subclass, and which is specified by O, or by writing overlapping near a Isar triangle. Like we can say one example, representation of disjoint and non-disjoint in ER diagram, right? Employee, one entity, these are two entities, professor, head, right? And this is a triangle. Near this is a triangle, we can write disjoint and non-disjoint. In case of disjoint constraint, we can write D or disjoint. In case of non-disjoint constraint, we can write O or overlapping or non-disjoint constraint. Okay? Now, second kind of constraint is participation constraint, or you can say completeness constraint. So it determines whether every member of superclass must participate as a member of subclass or not, right? So there are two kind of participation constraint, total participation and partial participation. Total means mandatory participation, or you can say partial means optional participation. right? When there is a total participation, we can connect our entity with particular relationship via double line like this, okay? And when there is a partial participation, we link on via single line that particular entity and with relationship, okay? Now total participation means total participation of entity set E in relationship set R is said to be total if every entity in E participates in at least one relationship in R. Okay, what it means, for example, see here, consider two entities, employee and department, related with the help of relationship works for, employees works for a particular department, right? So if company policy states that every employee must work for a department, right, then an employee entity can exist only if it participates at least one work for relationship instance, okay? Thus the participation of employee in works for is called total participation, okay? What it means, it means that every entity in total set of employee entities must be related to an department entity via works for, okay? Like this, see, total participation is also called existence dependency, okay? And total participation is displayed as a double line in ER diagram connecting the participating entity type to a relationship like this. Employee works for particular department, but what we can say that each and every employee is works for department, so this is total participation, right? It indicates via double line that each and every employee works for the department, okay? And partial participation, what it means, partial participation is when each entity in the entity set may not occur in at least one relationship in that relationship set, okay? For example, if company policy states that employee, that manager employee, right, must manage a department, however every employee may not manage a department, right? So the participation of employee in the manages relationship type is partial, right? Meaning is that some or part of the set of employee entities are related to some department entities via manages, but not necessarily all. It means in company there are multiple employees, right, but each and every employee works for a particular department, right? So works for a particular department, the works for is relationship which is connected with each and every employee, right? But this relationship manage is only with connected manager entity, not each and every entity, right? So you can say that partial participation is represented by a single line connecting entity in relationship, right? So this is your homework. You can say draw ER diagram of bank database, okay? So here is a hint, you can take entities like customer, account, loan, payment, branches, okay? And also you have to draw with mapping cardinality, including all types of attributes, type of entity and constraint, okay? Thank you.